corn, cars, soil, sororities, planters, pedestrians. Things you wouldn't normally associate together, but such is the case on the campus of the University of Missouri. Students walk by crops on the way to their dorms and their classes without a spare thought as to what they're passing or why it's there.
They go, oh, that's that green space, that field that's in the middle of campus.
The 4.5 acres of plots are known as Sanborn Field. They're used by researchers at the University of Missouri for long-term experimental studies. Their focus is on the various ways to manage agricultural land.
They were so successful, 130 years later, they're still here.
But what's the story? Who created the field, and why was it created? First, we must understand the history of our country's agricultural law. Americans of the mid-19th century saw a need for practical education. They made their opinions heard, and in 1862, Congress passed the Morrill Land Grant Acts. Introduced by Jonathan Turner and Justin Smith Morrill, these acts donated public lands to several states if they agreed to provide colleges for agricultural and mechanical training. Missouri accepted the provisions in 1863, and the College of Agriculture was created 7 years later in February of 1870. This was a time when most people's lives and livelihoods greatly depended on agriculture, and specifically crops and livestock. The majority of Missourians worked in the fields. Only a fraction were employed in industrial work. Science was ever expanding, with new questions and their answers illuminating the horizon. Enter a man named J.W. Sanborn. Sanborn was a New Hampshire native, graduating from the New Hampshire College of Agriculture. He came to Missouri, still a young state, in 1882 to fill the position of dean in the University of Missouri's College of Agriculture. In 1887, Congress passed another important law, the Hatch Act. This act provided funds for agricultural experiment stations across the nation and paved the way for research. 1 year later, and 6 years into his role as dean, Sanborn established what he called the Rotation Field. The field was located on the south edge of campus, away from most traffic. Sanborn designed the field for research. He hoped to answer questions from farmers about using different cropping systems. He wrote the field was designed to show the value of various rotations, of constant tillage crops on soil fertility, of chemicals fed according to crop analysis, to the necessity of rotation, and of various crops unmanured and soil fertility. Though Sanborn had success in establishing the rotation field, his administration while serving as dean was one full of conflict. After 7 years, the board of curators gave him an ultimatum: resign or be dismissed. Sanborn resigned in 1889, but the research Sanborn started during his time at the College of Agriculture didn't stop when he left. Though discussions about discontinuing the field arose in 1904, Dean H.J. Waters was in favor of maintaining it. He put Chairman of the Soils Department, M.F. Miller, in charge of it. And in 1914, the focus of the research changed from manure to chemical fertilizers. The University Board of Curators renamed the rotation field to Sanborn Field in 1924. Many significant findings have been made at Sanborn Field since its birth. One especially influential discovery was in 1945. A soil sample from plot 23 contained the bacterium Streptomyces areofaciens, the source of the so-called wonder drug, areomycin. Areomycin came to be known as the first tetracycline, chlorotetracycline, an antibiotic still commonly used today to treat various infections like acne. This historic soil sample now greets visitors of the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. Some other findings from Sanborn Field include the advantages and disadvantages of using manure, the need for limestone in crop production, the dynamics of carbon cycling, the impact of nitrogen fertilizers, and effective soil conservation practices.
Because of the research that's gone on here, we've been able to develop the principles and concepts of agricultural sustainability, and that is helping us move forward with our environmental issues, with food production.
As the oldest experimental plot west of the Mississippi River, Sanborn Field was named a registered National Historic Landmark by the National Park Service in 1965, along with the Dooley Miller Erosion Plots, also located on Mizzou's campus. The results from 130 years of research on Sanborn Field have benefited Missouri, the Midwest, and beyond. Publications from former students and their professors have reached a worldwide audience. Over the years, thousands of farmers and researchers have visited Sanborn Field. Each visitor experiences the findings of decades of crop and soil management research. They take that knowledge home with them, spreading the science of Sanborn around the world.
Sanborn Field is significant because it addresses the long-term effect of cultural practices on row crop production. Additionally, it has a very strong meaning to today's individuals who haven't had much of an agricultural background. Even though Sanborn Field was established 130 years ago, it's continuing to adapt to times. They added soybeans, no-till, grain sorghum, commercial fertilizer. What's next? That's what's exciting about Sanborn Field. It's adaptive.
The history of Sanborn Field lives on through today's students at the university. Though now in the middle of a busy campus, the field is a living laboratory for their learning.
A teaching lab, a teaching center.
We celebrate the past 130 years and look forward to the next 130 years with optimism.
I'm excited about the past, but equally excited about the future.
More questions, more research, and more knowledge will come. We can't wait to see what Sanborn Field will teach us next.